Hello children, welcome to the second part of wave optics chapter. In the last class we discussed extensively the concept of wave fronts and Huygens theory. Now in this class we are going to go to the next level where we will be discussing what exactly is interference of light, and before that we will be discussing what is a coherent source, right? And this is an important chapter for you for exams, and the topic you are doing today is very much relevant for all kind of exams, whether it is JEE, whether it is NEET or whether it is the board exams. So let's get started. Children, the first thing we understand today is the principle of superposition of waves. Okay? Principle of superposition of waves. We shall be discussing what is the principle of superposition of waves. We understood in Huygens theory that light is being transported through a medium, is being transported through a medium in the form of waves, right? Now, a wave is caused by vibrations of particles of a medium, okay? Now, as different waves are propagating in a medium, then suppose at a given instant I want to know what will be the net displacement of a particle of the medium, then how we will calculate this, that is given by the principle of superposition of waves. Let us understand this. Suppose a number of waves are propagating in a medium. One wave is going like this, the second wave is going like this. Obviously, their frequencies are not the same. Maybe another wave is going like this. And at a given instant t, this graph, time we have shown on x-axis and displacement y is given on the y-axis. Clear? So here we have t and y, t and y, and then t and y. Right? Now at a certain instant t dash or t1, suppose I want to calculate what is net displacement of the wave. So what I'll do is, I'll find out displacement y1 of the first wave here. This is y1. Then I'll find out displacement y2 of the second wave. And then I'll calculate displacement y3 of the third wave. Right? And I can go on. Then if I ask what the net displacement of the wave, then obviously the net displacement will be the vector sum of the individual displacements. And y will be, children, y1 vector plus y2 vector plus y3 vector, it just go on. Or we can say y is equal to sigma yi I1 to n. And this forms the basis for the principle of superposition of waves, right? And the law says if number of waves are propagating in a medium, then at a given instant, the net displacement of the wave is given by vector sum of displacements produced by individual waves, okay? Displacements. So, children, here we have the principle of superposition of waves, which says if number of waves are propagating in a medium, the net displacement of the wave at a given instant is equal to the vector sum of individual displacements, or y equals to y1 plus y2 plus y3 and so on, right? So depending on, so we'll be adding all the displacements vectorially, they cannot be added like what? Numbers. Now we'll try to understand another example where we have like you understand that when you talk about any transverse wave, it's traveling in the form of what? Crests and troughs. So let's simplify the discussion and come to a point where waves are superimposed in such a manner that they are in phase and they are out of phase. Let's see how will this net wave be illustrated. This is one wave. Let's see another wave. This wave is having smaller amplitude. There are two waves which are superimposing. See, this is one complete cycle of the wave. from here to here. As you know, this is T and this is displacement Y for the first wave, T and this is Y for the second wave. Let us say this amplitude is A1 and this amplitude is A2. You can clearly see that here crest and crests, both the crests are meeting together. Clearly, if you draw a line here, through 1/4 of the time period, you know this is how much children? T/4. So you can see that the crests actually what superimposing together. Imagine situation in which A1, the first wave goes up by distance A1 and the second also goes up by distance A2. So what will happen? These two both will be pushing the same particle in the same direction, and therefore the net displacement will be given by the wave here. Net displacement will be how much? A1 plus A2. It will become how much? I'll draw a little bigger. So it will become A1 plus A2. Did the net wave have a displacement? A1 plus A2. Did the positive displacement? In the negative direction also, displacement is going to be the same, and that will be here again A1 plus A2. So this is the net wave, this is T and this is Y, net wave, and this will be the net displacement, that is A1 plus A2. Right, the crests are meeting together in phase, and then trough is also meeting together in phase. This is case one. Now let's see another case where they are in opposite phases. Like here we have children. This is A1. Right, this is A1, same wave, same amplitude, this is time and this displacement Y. Now imagine another situation when this is A1, the other wave is going something like this, it is in opposite phase. Here if you see, these two waves are superimposing. Crest is superimposing with the trough. So they are opposite. Imagine a situation in which you push a particle upwards by the distance what? A1, and again simultaneously you push the particle by distance A2 downwards. So what will be the net displacement? The net displacement will be, because the phase difference is 180 degree between them. If you add, it will be subtractive addition of both of these. So it will be A1 minus A2. So the net wave will be having very small amplitude. It will have a small amplitude like this. This will be, if you see this, will be A1 minus A2. This is going to be very small, A1 minus A2, right? Very small amplitude. And again, in the negative direction, if you see, this will be same, right? So, when a crest will meet with crest, the amplitude will be maximum in positive direction, trough will meet with trough, will maximum in the negative direction. However, it will be meeting out of phase. Here we have A1 and A2, so you can see that it will be greater amplitude minus marginal amplitude, and the amplitude has been greatly diminished. Clear? Now, in ideal situation, imagine two waves are superimposing on each other. And during this superposition, their amplitudes are equal. This is ideal case for superposition. Let's see what will happen in this case. This is the first wave that we are having. Its amplitude is A. Clear? Now, there is this other wave. Its amplitude is also A. Its amplitude is also A. Now, if these two waves are superimposing children, amplitude in each case is A, this is also A, and this is time,
Then what will be the net temperature? A plus A will be 2A. And then this will be something like 2A. Something like this. So you see, by now you must have been very clear about this concept. You must have got clear idea about this superimposition, that when the two waves are meeting in such a manner that crest and crest are together and trough are together, they will be generating what? Larger amplitude. However, when their crests and troughs are meeting together, then the amplitude is going to be diminished. When A1 is equal to 8 in this case, the net amplitude is how much? 2. When they are meeting in phase. But what will happen, children, if in this diagram I make A1 is equal to A2, then what will happen? Let us see this scenario. When A1 is equal to A2, then what we will get? Okay. Now, children, let us see another ideal situation when both the amplitudes are equal and they are meeting in opposite phase. Let us see here. This amplitude is A, suppose. This is A, so I will also take this as A. This is A, I will take in opposite phase, sorry. Let us take in opposite phase. Now let us see what will happen to the resultant wave in this case. You can see that one trough is meeting what? And the crest. So you are going up by a distance A and coming down by a distance A. What will be displacement? Then displacement will be 0. Similarly, in this case, in case of the first wave, you are going down by a distance A and the second goes up by a distance A. So what will be displacement in this case also? 0. So if I draw the net wave will become something like this. It will be from here to here, it will be linear. What will be displacement? This is T and this is Y. In this case, displacement is going to be equal to how much? 0. So this phenomenon is very important. The result of the principle of superposition of waves, that waves will be added vectorially. If the crest and crest are meeting together, a trough and trough are meeting together, then net amplitude will be maximum. However, if trough and crest are meeting together, then the amplitude will be minimum. In ideal case, when A1 is equal to A2 and they are meeting in opposite phase, then the net displacement, the net amplitude is going to be equal to how much? 0. Once you understood this, children, then we will go on to understand what is the coherent source, and then we will go for understanding what is interference. Okay. Coherent sources. Now, if two sources of light emit waves having same frequency and same wavelength, very important, and the waves are, which are being emitted by them, either in the same phase or the constant phase difference, then the two sources are called what? Coherent sources. Suppose there are two sources of light, one is S1, S1 is emitting light, and then we have a source S2, that is also emitting light, and these are independent sources, right? So these two sources will be called coherent sources if and only if they are emitting light having same frequency, nu1 is equal to nu2, same wavelength, lambda1 is equal to lambda2, and the phase is same, phi is constant, or phase difference phi is equal to 0. Then only they will act as coherent sources. Children, remember, light is emitted by individual atoms, not by matter as a whole. Each light emits its own, each atom emits its own light, and the light emitted by the atom has its own configuration. So when I am saying there is a source of light S1, then S1 is composed of trillions of atoms, very large number of atoms. Now to say the light emitted by S1 will be of same configuration as light emitted by S2 is very wrong. because we cannot have all these characteristics same in the two independent sources. So two sources of light cannot be coherent sources. Okay, so let's define what are coherent sources. Phase difference are called coherent sources. So this will be an important definition they'll ask in the exam. Two sources emitting light having same frequency, same wavelength, same phase or constant phase difference is called coherent sources. Now the question is, how we can have coherent sources? Can two independent sources act as coherent sources? No. Two independent sources can never have all these characteristics what? Same. So what are conditions for this one? Conditions for being coherent sources. First one is that frequency should be same. Right? Number two, wavelength should be same. And number three, phi should be zero or it should be constant. So children, all these parameters cannot be made same with two coherent or two independent sources. So therefore we conclude that independent sources, so children, there is an important point for you to note that independent sources cannot be treated as coherent sources because all these parameters cannot be same when they are emitting light, because light is emitted by individual atoms and not by the bulk as a whole. We consider each atom when we study these characteristics. Now the question is, how we can produce coherent sources? Actually children, for obtaining coherent sources, the best answer comes from Huygens theory itself. If you remember Huygens theory, it says that each point lying in the path of light acts as a secondary source of light. So that's the best option that we have for having coherent sources. That means if here we have a source of light S, S is a source of light, and then imagine a situation in which I place a number of slits, like one slit is S1, the other slit is S2, I can put another slit also S3, I can put so many of these slits. Now Huygens theory says that S1, S2 and S3 will act same as the original source of light, meaning now they will be emitting light having same characteristics as the light emitted by the original source S, meaning they will have light having same frequency and wavelength and also same phase as the phase emitted by the original source S. So the best way to produce coherent sources is by placing slits in the path of incident light. If you have light traveling from a source and you place a number of slits in the path of this light, then each slit will act as what? As a coherent source, right? So coherent sources can be produced by placing a number of slits in the path of the incident light. And then here you have to know that the best solution for producing coherent sources is coming from the Huygens theory itself, right? So coherent sources can be produced by placing a number of slits in the path of the incident light, and each slit will act as original source of light. Clear? Okay. Now,
Part difference and phase difference. We'll see the relation between part difference and phase difference, because you must be clear about this. We'll be using it very often. Path difference and phase difference. Imagine there are two sources of light and of course they are coherent sources. One is S1 and the other is S2. Now S is, here we have original source of light, light is traveling from S. S1 and S2 will become secondary sources of light. They will be emitting light from here and this light will fall on a screen. Imagine I place a screen here. There will be light all over the place traveling from S1 and S2, it will be falling on the screen. Now imagine there is a point P on the screen at which the two waves
traveling from S1 to S2 are meeting. Right? There will be infinite number of points and the skin will be discussing again later on in double slit experiment, but just to understand the concept of path difference and phase difference. Now see, light traveling from S1 to S2, which is incident at point P, is taking what? Paths are different length. See, the light traveling from S1 to P is taking what length? S1P. And the distance similarly traveled by the light from S2 to point P is what? S2P. Obviously, you can see the path length of the light taken from S2 is greater than path length of the light taken from S1. So, literally, children, the difference between the paths taken by the two waves is called path difference. Very simply, path difference, if I denote it by x, then x will be S2P minus S1P. You can understand the analogy, the two friends, one is S1, the other is S2. They both decide to travel along straight lines and meet at point P. Then the one traveling from S2 is taking more distance. So, difference between the path lengths is called path difference. We may denote it by x, or delta, even you can use, is equal to S2P minus S1P. Now, there is another way we can derive this. In fact, if I draw a perpendicular from S1 on S2P and suppose this angle is theta and the perpendicular is Q, then the distance S2Q will be equal to the path difference. If the distance is D, then keep in mind, we will be using this concept also. If I use sin theta here, this angle is 90, then sin theta will be equal to, this will be the path difference x, x by d, then path difference will be x is equal to d sin theta. Clear? So, x is equal to, if you know the path length, we will directly use s2p minus s1p, or you can use x is equal to d sin theta. So, you can clearly see as theta will change, then x will also change. Then we can generalize this result. Xn is equal to d sin theta n, where theta n is variable value of theta for different waves. Clear? So, this is the story of path difference. Now, what is phase difference? Phase difference is basically the difference between the angles described by the two waves. Clear? Imagine here a wave is traveling, is propagating here like this, and a particle is located at this point. We regard path difference as what? X, and the phase difference with respect to origin is phi. So, we can denote it as what? Phi. And we may try to seek a relation between what is the different relation between path difference and phase difference. If I go from here to here, children, then you very well know that this distance is equal to how much here? Lambda. The distance from here to here is how much here? Lambda. You know the distance traveled by a particular wave in one time period is equal to the wavelength. And from here to here, how much is the phase difference? Phase difference if I see with respect to origin? 2 pi. Right? So, we can say like this, when path difference is lambda, phase difference is 2 pi. When path difference is 1, I can use unitary method, then what will be the phase difference? 2 pi by lambda. So, when path difference is x, the what will be phase difference? 2 pi by lambda into x. So, this is the value of phase difference when path difference is equal to x, and therefore, we have another formula coming up your way, and you remember this, that phase difference is equal to 2 pi by lambda into path difference, or phi is equal to 2 pi by lambda into x. So, this relation will be important for you to know. Phi is equal to 2 pi by lambda into x, where phi is the phase difference and x is used as path difference. Different books have different symbols, but this is generalized formula which you can always use. Clear? Okay. Now, children, we are going to discuss an important topic, that is interference. What exactly is interference? Children, you have to remember, you have been in class 11 waves chapter, if you remember, simple harmonic motion, and subsequently after that, that energy carried by a wave is directly proportional to the square of amplitude.
E is directly proportional to amplitude square.
Yes. And now there is another term here we'll be using very often in this chapter. This is called intensity of light or intensity of wave. So what is intensity of wave, children? Intensity of a wave, in fact, is the area which is passing normal to a given surface at through unit area. The energy which is passing perpendicular to a given surface area through unit area of 1 meter square is called what? Intensity of the wave. So as the energy is directly proportional to what? Amplitude square, then intensity
is what? Area passing, energy passing through unit area at right angle. I will be directly proportional to what? A square as well. I is equal to be writing k into a square, where k is a constant. K is a constant,
right? So intensity of wave or light will be directly proportional to square of amplitude. That's what you need to keep in mind. And intensity, the amount of energy which is passing through unit surface area at right angle, right? That's called intensity. Now once you understand this, we will understand what exactly is interference. Let's understand this, and then we'll go into the details again. We have another situation here.
Let's see, there are two sources of this. Suppose a monochromatic source of light.
This source of light is what? Monochromatic source.
And then what I'm doing is I'm placing two slits in front of this source,
right? So what this source will do?
This source will be emitting light. Suppose, so what will be the nature of the waves? Will be emitting what? Waves like this, right?
So
suppose crest, the positive amplitude, I saw by a continuous line. The crest, that the negative slope, always showing using a dotted line. So dotted line will be representing what?
A trough. And the continuous line will be showing what? A crest. So imagine, let's say it is emitting a crest.
Then it is emitting a crest. Then what will happen? Then a trough will come. Similarly, a crest will come, and this process will go on.
And the waves will be emitting from this
slits S1 and S2, because S1 and S2 will act as what?
Secondary sources of light. They will also be coherent sources. So
imagine the situation in which you have crest first coming out. Then we have trough represented by dotted line here. Then what will come out?
A crest will come out.
So crest will be there through both. And then imagine a situation in which a trough comes out, right? Similarly, a trough will come out. Now see, it's important for you to know.
Let's discuss. At this point, what is happening? Two continuous lines are meeting, right? Means one crest is meeting another crest. When one crest will be meeting another crest, then what will happen? The amplitude will be maximum. When amplitude will be maximum, then intensity of light I is directly proportional to what? Amplitude square. So intensity here will be maximum.
Now, if I look here at this point,
then you can see a crest, a continuous line, is meeting with what? A dotted line here. So a crest is meeting a trough. So what will happen? They will cancel each other.
Clear? Now if I go in the vicinity here, then what do I see?
When I go here, then I see that a trough is meeting a trough. Again, both are in the same phase, so amplitude will be maximum. So we can say that as the waves are coming out of these two slits, then troughs and crests will continue to meet with each other, right? And the lights now traveling from these can be easily projected on a screen. Clear? Now if I have suppose another crest and yet another crest, then again more waves will be coming out. See here, at this point crest and trough are meeting, so this wave will go. Here trough and trough are meeting, then this will go, and all this light will fall on a screen here. We'll place a screen, and then here we'll place an eyepiece, because you won't be able to see with the naked eye. And then what do you see? You see that in this case we get a bright spot. Then you get here what? A dark spot. Then here we get what? A bright spot. Then you get here what? A dark spot. Means if you place two slits in front of a monochromatic source of light, then you find that alternate bright and dark spots are produced. This is very interesting. Means one spot here on the screen, what will I see? I'll say this spot is bright, then this will be dark. Again this will be bright, then this will be dark. Again this will be bright, and then this will be bright, and this will be dark. Alternately, these bright and dark spots are being formed on the screen. This phenomenon is what you call is interference. Now we can understand interference from a common man's standpoint also in a very easy way. With two loudspeakers, you place one loudspeaker this side and place another loudspeaker this side. You'll find there'll be a number of points at which the sound will become inaudible. Right? Suddenly come what? Inaudible. They'll tend to cancel each other. However, if you place both of them facing the same direction, here will be finding that there will be increase intensity and decrease in intensity at some points. And that will happen what? Alternately. If you spill oil on the surface of water, and if you shine a torch beam on this, and when even the natural light falls on it, you can see beautiful colors on this. This all relates to this phenomenon of interference. Clear? So what is happening? Actually, let's see, let's go to the bottom of this. This spot where we have a crest meeting a crest. Let's see what is happening here. A crest is meeting another crest. Like this, they are in the same phase, and this is the net wave. I will make the amplitude 2a. This is the net wave. If this is A and this is A, then this is 2a. You can see the amplitude has become very large. If amplitude has become very large, then what is happening? We are going to get lots of intensity at that particular point where these two waves are meeting, like in this case for example, right? So when the amplitude will be maximum, then energy will be maximum. When energy will be maximum, then what will happen, children? Will appear like what? A bright spot. So this is how I'm getting here what? A bright spot. Clear? Now in the next case, imagine a situation. This is case one. Imagine a situation in which I have, this is A and this is A. Their amplitudes are same, but they are in opposite phase. Then what will happen? The net wave will appear to be something like this. It will have zero amplitude. It will have what amplitude? Zero amplitude. If amplitude is zero, then energy is also what? Zero. Then what will you find here? What? You will find dark spot. Right? And the situation, children, we have in which two crests are meeting in phase like this,
two crests emitting in phase. So the amplitude of the net wave will be doubled, it will become something like this two way. In this case also we will get what? A bright spot. So means when a crest is meeting a crest, a trough is meeting a crest, trough is meeting a trough, then the amplitude is maximum and you are getting a bright spot. However, when a crest is meeting a trough, then we are having what? Zero amplitude or minimum amplitude, and we are getting what spot? Dark spot. So this phenomenon is what is what we are calling is interference. And remember that these spots, bright and dark, will be formed alternately. It will not happen that we will have two adjacent bright or we will have two adjacent dark spots. Clear? Once again, if a trough will meet a, if a crest will meet a crest, what will you get, children? Will get a bright spot. However, when a trough will meet a crest, so this will be what spot? Dark spot. If you meet, if here we have a trough meeting a trough, then in this case also what will you get? Will get a bright spot. So in two cases, crest crest will meet, will get what? Bright spot. Trough trough will get what? Bright spot. And then trough and crest will give you a dark spot. So I'll be writing here, crest plus crest will give you bright spot B, trough plus trough will give you also bright, but crest with trough will give you dark. Here range is maximum, so intensity is also maximum. Here energy is zero, so intensity is also minimum, right? Minimum is equal to zero, the intensity is also zero. Clear? So we discuss a brief thing, we had a brief discussion about what exactly is interference. So we will define interference, we will be writing the definition, we will also be seeing what are the conditions, then we will come to mathematical treatment of this and also conditions for different types of interference. Produced. This phenomenon is called interference. This phenomenon is called interference. So children, when monochromatic light, now this term monochromatic means wavelength is same, okay? When monochromatic light, single color, that means, when monochromatic light from coherent sources traveling the same direction undergoes superposition, then alternate bright and dark spots are produced. This phenomenon is called what? Interference. Clear? So you have understood by now that the whole story of interference is revolving actually around what? Superposition. When the amplitude is maximum, that is trough plus trough or crest plus crest, it will be a bright spot. And we will be using this term. A spot here will be called fringe. We will be using fringe. Clear? So bright spot will be called bright fringe, okay? And dark spot will be called what? Dark fringe. So you need to keep in mind. And these fringes are coming on the screen what? Alternately, one after the other, one bright, one dark, one bright, one dark. Clear? Now you answer this, then we'll be discussing what exactly, how exactly it is related with phase difference and path difference, and under what conditions we'll get a bright spot and we'll get what? A dark spot. Now, so we'll be seeing how many types of interference is there. Actually, there are basically two types of interference. The formation of bright spot is called what? Constructive interference. Constructive interference or additive superposition. And the formation of dark spot is called destructive interference or subtractive superposition. So we'll be seeing, children, types of interference. I'll be writing types of interference now. There are two slits here, S1 and S2. And on the screen, I'm getting bright spot, dark spot, bright spot, dark spot. Below also will have dark spot, bright spot, dark spot. We will go on like this. Clear? So there are two types of interference we'll have. Types of interference. We'll have two types. First one is called constructive interference. Constructive interference.
Now, what is constructive interference, children? When two waves undergo interference to produce a bright spot, then it is called what? Constructive interference. Okay. Let's define. If
the interference is called constructive interference,
so children, when two waves undergo interference or superposition to produce a bright fringe, then it is called what? Constructive interference. And what are conditions? Actually, we are deriving, when we discuss analytical treatment of interference, we'll be deriving the conditions also of interference.
So, conditions for constructive interference. What are the conditions, children? There are two conditions for constructive interference that I have to remember. First one is path difference x should be integral multiple of wavelength,
meaning x should be equal to n lambda. Path difference should be integral multiple of wavelength. Actually, this law is also expressed like this. This is between 2n into lambda by 2. I can write like this also, na? So you can also say it is even multiple of half the wavelength, and the light is monochromatic, so both the wavelengths are same. Bear in mind. And number two, phase difference
should be even multiple of or integral multiple of 2 pi. Integral multiple of 2 pi,
meaning phi will be equal to n into 2 pi, or phi is equal to 2n pi. So these will be conditions for constructive interference. The path difference will be integral multiple of lambda. Phase difference will be integral multiple of 2 pi, or path difference will be integral even multiple of half the wavelength, and phase difference will be even multiple of pi. So both way you can remember, meaning
you can also write like this, r phi is equal to 2n into pi. Now what is pi? Now pi is what? 180 degree.
So we saw the condition for constructive interference, that x should be equal to n lambda and phi should be equal to 2n pi. Now children, what is destructive interference? Destructive interference will take place when two waves from coherent sources emitted by monochromatic light will be superimposing to produce what? A dark spot. So we'll be defining what is your destructive interference, and also will be
destructive interference. Interference is called destructive interference. So children,
if two waves of coherent sources undergo superposition to produce what? A dark spot, then interference is called what? Destructive interference. And the conditions are,
first one is path difference is odd multiple of half the wavelength, lambda by 2, meaning x should be equal to 2n minus 1 into lambda by 2, and as it is 2n minus 1, you will start with n is equal to 1, 2. Remember, you will not be taking n is equal to 0. If it is 2n plus 1, you can take n is equal to 0. First condition, path difference should be odd multiple of lambda by 2. And the second thing is, phase difference should be
odd multiple of pi.
So phase difference should be odd multiple of pi.
So phi is equal to children 2n minus 1 into pi. Here also you will be using n is equal to 1, 2, 3. We'll start with n is equal to 1.
You can't take 0 because it becomes negative. It will value for negative also, but it will be taking positive values and start with n is equal to 1. Clear? So you see the difference. In case of constructive interference, x was 2n, even multiple of lambda by 2. Here it is odd multiple. Same things reversed, and phi, phase difference odd multiple of pi. And remember that a constructive interference is called maxima. Constructive interference will be calling also maxima. Maxima is actually plural of maximum. And destructive interference will be referred to as very often as minima. So these terms also should be, you should be familiar with. So we discussed, we had an idea in this video as to what exactly is interference, what types and what conditions it takes place. Okay, thank you.